recording this. All right, so welcome aboard. And while we wait for others to join, this is part two of the Crafting Research Proposals Zoom conferences. Yesterday we had the part one in which we predominantly covered some basics and then we went deep into literature review. And given that this is such a vast area of study, I am trying my best to be able to compress it into two conferences, i.e. yesterday and today. But I've also received some requests. I know Rashmi made a request and then Mahmood made a request to me just this morning that he would like to have me offer another makeup session so that we can cover in some depth some of the areas, so not rush through everything, but cover some areas in more depth, okay, rather than just breadth. So I'm considering that, and for no extra expense, I will offer a third meeting to you all, okay, and another 2-hour meeting, but we'll have to wait for about a week for me to do that because I have other stuff on my plate this week. So, but I take that that very seriously because there's no point in rushing through everything. I want to make sure that the research of literature, the research methodology design, and at least the introduction chapter, they're all done very, very thoroughly with all the nuances and all the details. So with that, Anchal, you were asking a question. Why don't you go ahead and ask your question now?
Yeah. So I was asking that, can the need to study a problem also arise from one's personal experience? For example, let's say I want to work on caste and dominance of caste in agriculture in Himachal.
Yeah. Yeah.
And let's say that there are evidences suggesting that there is a dominance of a particular social group on the other, and it manifests itself in agricultural productivity and the extension services offered by the government to people. Uh-huh. And but I have also, since I've lived in Himachal, I am from Himachal, I've seen the agriculture of Himachal very closely, and yes, I've observed certain things here. So okay, can the study a certain problem also arise from what I've observed?
What a wonderful question starting out today's conference. What a powerful question. And rather than me providing you and everybody else the answer, because that will only be my limited take on that, what I would like to do is to open this forum out to others, including yourself, and you lead this conversation right now. Okay, Anchal, see, I put you on the spot right now. Are you in Shimla right now or are you in Delhi right now?
I'm in Shimla, sir.
Shimla, wow, beautiful. I was in Shimla a couple of years ago. What a beautiful place. It's so developed now. But did everybody hear Anchal's question? Can you develop a research problem or whatever based on your own experiences?
I would like to share that. Sorry for the bus noise and the traffic at the back. But
no, go ahead.
The thing is, normally when I offer a subject or something to research on, I usually look around problems that are in my community or society, as I said yesterday. So sometimes even the problems are related to you. For instance, like my recent reason to have research on my PhD in LBP, like lower back pain, is because I have that and I want to understand why I developed it and why, how it feels for others and how they actually, you know, work with it along in their daily life. For me, research is always something that could be helpful in your society and that has actually affected you in some extent, even at your perception level or even in your thinking patterns. So I pick topics that are affecting the community.
Absolutely amazing. That's a great great take on that. Anybody else? Why? Because your experiences are pulling you in a certain direction. Okay, your mind is going in a certain direction, and you have questions that keep you awake at night. All right, that you often ruminate about. So, Anybody else wants to share?
Yeah, I could add. Hi, Siddharth this side.
Hi, Siddharth.
Am I audible?
Yeah. Can you, by the way, see me also?
Yes.
Okay, good. I wanted to share because I wasn't seeing my own avatar here. But go ahead, Siddharth. Tell us.
Yeah, sure. So in my opinion, I think research definitely starts inside out. In terms of what we are passionate about and what or what I am passionate about and what I like. And then I try and see how it can, if it is also beneficial to the larger society. So it's probably in my mind, it's the intersection of both what I am passionate about and what could be of maximum benefit to the society. If I'm not passionate, probably the sustainability of the research or my passion for it won't last long. If I'm thinking only about what is the best ROI for this research, or how can I maximize it? How can society, if I remove myself out of the research, I'll probably burn out soon.
Beautiful.
If I'm only thinking about myself and not the viability of or the usefulness to the society, then probably I'll become resentful later.
Excellent. So you're talking about what we call generativity, which I talked about briefly yesterday. Generativity means, is your research going to help others down the road? Help society, help your community, help your family, help your friends, whatever the case may be. Or is it just going to be that at the very end, add to the extant literature? That's very sterile, according to me. While that is very important, but really your immediate goals ought to be, first of all, I love the way you said, Siddharth, it has to be inside out, correct? So if something is getting stirred up within you that you want to research, that you want to talk about, that you want to delve more into, it's kind of like, people get drawn to the field of psychology, psychoanalysis, therapy and all that because they have oftentimes some unresolved issues within themselves, which intrigue them. And they want to understand them more, not only experientially, but also theoretically. All right. So they enter those programs. So likewise, Anchal has raised a wonderful question. Thank you, Anchal, for raising that question. Anybody else? Thanks, Siddharth.
Okay. So
Siddharth,
I have a question. I would like to speak a little bit on that because
go ahead, please, Rashmi. Yeah.
It's been a journey, and I'm sure Shikha would also agree with me. We've been on this journey for a very long time now. Mm-hmm. And in this journey, we came across two types of researchers. Mm-hmm. One who are really doing, if I break the word down into researching, that means they're just adding certain variables and doing the research.
I like that. I like the way you're putting it, researching, researching. Correct?
And the other lot is one who are exploring and learning. Okay. And that is where Arjun's question lies about my experience. So if I'm passionate about something, if I observe a phenomena and I'm passionate about that phenomena, then I want to do something about it and it relates something to the society, probably that is a course I've been traveling on.
Right.
So when this kind of researchers, they take a lot of trial, they introspect a lot of things, but the other lot, which is just researching, they finish it up really quickly.
Correct.
So when you take up research and you are passionate and you are exploring an experience or an idea or a concept, then you need to also have some amount of patience in you. Even if you don't have, the years will actually bring in all that kind of patience in you.
Correct.
So research is, it's all about building your own personality, about building your own. It's just not what you're creating and writing and presenting in the form of a dissertation. It's also how you're growing up with an experience through a phenomena that you have wanted to explore.
So that's excellent. So, and you know, when we talk about these various doctrines that we will discuss later in the presentation today, when we talk about methods and methodology, that you have to have a philosophy of life, okay? Not only your own personal life philosophy and worldview. I think yesterday, Siddharth, also known as Sid, was talking about some worldviews and all that. Which I like that. I wanted to also talk about the worldviews and all that. So all of that conglomerate brings to mind in the notion that if this is something that I'm observing deeply, this is touching my heart, this is touching my soul, I want to understand this from a research standpoint, not just read about it, not just talk about it, but I want to research this. Then the doctrine of interpretism, which means interpreting or making sense of, making meaning of something, becomes very critical, okay? And there are interpretative paradigms like phenomenology and narrative inquiry and case study method. So all of them have some level of interpretation. All right. So this was an excellent question. So I want to turn it over to others who have not spoken. It's very, very important understanding that your experiences can lead you to sometimes, Rashmi, to the best research questions out there. Okay, it all starts from within. So go ahead. Who else wants to jump in?
If I can just add one more bit, I'll be very brief.
Take your time. Take your time. Yeah.
So I recently encountered a concept of mission, and I know a mission statement are something a lot of organizations talk about and all, and they have become a cliche, but if we understand mission, I think research for me it is like a mission, and it is an intersection of both what is very personal to you and as well as what the society really needs. A mission cannot be one of the two. So I really liked that. Yeah,
and we also often talk about in research the three concepts, the three major constructs which were derived from Greek literature was ethos, pathos, and logos. Ethos is the ethics, right? Not only societal ethics, but what are your personal ethics, all right? And research and ethics have a very strong relationship, okay? You cannot be a researcher if you're not an ethical person. I mean, you can be, but ethics is required, academic ethics. Then your personal ethics, how you lead your life, right? Okay, your own integrity. So that is ethos. Pathos is emotions, feelings, tender. I mean, going deep into that, not feeling, oh, I'm feeling sad, I'm feeling bad, I'm feeling glad, I'm feeling mad. Those are surface feelings. But going deep down when you're interviewing qualitatively, which is all about thoughts, feelings, emotions, perceptions, you have to have the capacity as a researcher to go really deep into the inner theater of somebody and draw that person out. So I like the way Siddharth had put it that, you know, when you're in this, you're in this together, you have to decide whether you want to be a quantitative researcher, which is all about numerical data, all right? You're going to stand apart like a hands-off observer of something that's happening, which is okay. That's quantitative for you. That's positivist science. In qualitative, it's different. You're talking about all this mumbo jumbo about thoughts, feelings, emotions, and how are they connecting. To connect the dots in that can be very difficult. So if you are having a personal experience of something, which is compelling, like Anshul said, she's been in Shimla and she's very, very, close to the agricultural community. She had seen some things up close in the agricultural community and she wants to reflect on that. She wants to go deeper into that. So that is very it's a very compelling argument to make, because sometimes what will happen is you're in a PhD program, and some PhD programs are very bureaucratic. Like they, your assessor, your faculty will tell you, here are some of the topics that I will give you. You pick one of them and do your research and do your stuff on that. They will not allow you, okay, the freedom to bring your own topic into it. But they'll say, no. This is the rules with an organization a university has. Now, more and more universities are now recognizing the importance of creativity, because if you're going to be into a research program for the next 4 years or 5 years, you better be talking about something that you're passionate about, not what your researcher is passionate about. Researcher meaning your faculty member. If you're doing what is important to the faculty member, you're not going to be doing that for too long. It has to be a personal stake for you. You're waking up in the middle of the night thinking about this. The elbow grease, the burning the midnight oil, right? Burning the candle at both ends. You're going to go through all that, my friend. I've been through that, all the grunt work, right? You just don't get awarded the PhD. You'll have to go through the grind to get that. So this is great. Now, anybody else that, hi, Kanika, can you hear us? I don't think she can. Oh, Kanika, can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Okay. Welcome aboard.
I'm here. Thank you.
Okay, good. So, Kanika, the question that Anshul had asked before you joined was, is it okay to go into your own personal experiences in order to come up with some sort of a research question or research position or research problem? And what would be your personal take on that?
Oh, well, I think that during the research as well, we are just going to be experiencing the research personally. So the previous experiences cannot be discounted. So I do think that at some point, some of the theory or the research proposal that we are going to work on must be inspired, if not like completely drawn from it, but definitely... I mean, I don't know what is the ideal, but I would say that I can't, even if it's coming from my subconscious, it is in a way part of my research proposal, whatever my experience has been. So, for example, I'm going to be working on mindfulness and management. So I do draw a lot of, kind of experience from my own journey that mindfulness has actually given a lot of... benefits in my business pursuits. So I do think that I don't know what aspect of it will we delve into when we are formalizing, but I do see that it should be inspired by that. I mean, that's what my point of view is.
I think that's very important. It's also called researcher reflexivity, i.e. what is happening to you as a researcher in the research.
Right.
How is the researcher impacting you? How are you impacting the research? Okay, so we call that reflexivity, both conscious and unconscious, right? Sure. So that's why that's good. That's a nice take on that. Anybody else? Nitin, what about you, sir?
Yeah, I'm Nitin.
Go ahead.
Personal experience is something which always plays a very important role, because this is something...
Can you speak a little louder, Nitin?
Give me a moment.
Hello.
Is it okay now?
Yeah, much better. It was muffled earlier.
Sorry.
So go ahead.
So what I was saying is my personal experience with research is that I have always... almost always indulge in those subjects which I have been working on. Mm-hmm. Like for now, I am working with slum dwellers, their condition of water and hygiene.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm trying to indulge more into it, trying to connect with it. And of course, I'm thinking that there could be a research topic into it, wherein we can find something. But most of the time when I do these things, this is not for research purpose per se.
Mm-hmm.
most of the time it is for policy level decision making, for advocacy. Right. And that is where I end most of the times. Right. That is also because my job profile is such. But then yes, such can come from your personal experience, and I guess most of the times it does.
Right. And so Dr. Nitin brings up a very important question here, or an observation here, that so you're intrigued. Okay, so you are experiencing something, you're watching something, and it's keeping you up at night, right? And you're not a researcher yet, right? But you want to read more about it. You go to the library, you pull out some books on that, you go into the internet, do a search, read up on that. It satisfies your curiosity, and that's the end of it. But is that research? No, that's not research, right? That's just your curiosity being satisfied through your readings, through your interactions with others, through others' experiences. You may be attending a conference on your topic, but that's not research. Research is a whole different animal altogether, right? And so when we say crafting effective research proposals, it is not crafting a colloquial or just a casual proposal. We are doing something that has structure, that's meaning, that has rigor, that is robust in nature. Okay, so that's great. Thank you, Nitin. How about Everett? Everett, what do you think? Everett?
Yes.
So what do you think about your personal experiences becoming the research proposal or research question?
Well, for me, it's basically what some of my other peers have mentioned as well. Mm-hmm. Wanting to research a topic comes from my own desire and of my own observations as well. And also it is influenced by worldview. So that's what I would say in short.
Right. And for those of you that don't know, Everett is a seasoned midwife, also teaches nursing in Jamaica, all right? And Everett and I are working together on her proposals and everything else. So thank you for sharing that. How about Chandresh? Chandresh?
Yeah, good evening. Good morning, in fact, to many of them there, and good evening to people in India.
Go ahead.
So, I kind of agree with most of them that have spoken as peers that it's very important for the researchers who are coming into the field today, and even more so today than in the past, because access to knowledge is no longer as difficult as it was about, say, 15, 20 years before. Right. So, you know, probably just getting a research paper, I've heard from many of our professors that they would have to probably apply for it through their library, and they will get it after 2 months, then they can go through it and then come back. Today, at a click of a button, you get access to tons of knowledge. Exactly. What will differentiate is only the personal aspect that you can bring in. And unless until the personal aspect is not connected, I don't think it will draw in the depth of the work that you will want to do, because if it's not connected to you, I don't think it is going to join the depth that is needed to bring in and add anything to the body of knowledge that is there. And especially for new researchers, because you're already going to struggle with getting to understand the format, you know, knowing the nuances. And if your research area is not connected to what you have some prior knowledge of, mm-hmm. then it will become just something very superficial to go in and complete the degree. And I don't think that's going to really help in the long run, because that will be the foundation that you're laying to this domain that you're getting into. If at the start of it and you're spending the first 2-3 years into it and you don't really go through the grind, like you said, I don't think you're creating the right base for ourselves as we go forward. And most of us, I think, whatever work experience we are coming in with, 5 years to 10, 20 years, that you would be bringing in. We all understand that in any area of our career, the foundational years were very, very critical. And if you had not gone through the grind in those foundational years, then I don't think we are able to really add value as we grow. And we really see that when you spend a decade and more, but yes, that you missed out something during the time of foundation. And from a research standpoint, I think this will be the foundational part of what we are going to do. So
that is excellent. So, Iman, I saw your hand go up, but before you before I give it to you, let me just go to Shikha, okay?
Okay.
And see what Shikha has to say about this. Shikha, go ahead.
I don't have anything else to add. Most of this has been added. Just one thing, like I'm working in the area of gerontology, that is so much, like a lot of things I get into this area on my personal experience, on the basis of my personal experience. What I was seeing around, like people are staying alone, their children are not staying with them, how are they managing their things? So with that, my whole idea of research started. So that's the only thing I have to add.
So gerontology, that she's meaning old foggies like
study
me.
Old age. Study of old age. From the socio-psychological perspective,
Great. I was chuckling because when you said gerontology, my antenna went up. I said, "Oh, I'm in that group." Okay. So that is all good stuff. Okay, excellent. Everybody has had a chance to say, and thank you again, Anshul, for raising such an important question. It's a very, very critical question. And as you can see, Anshul, that everybody has had something to say. Now, does that sort of, Anshul, help you a little bit in understanding?
Yeah, it does. I think, yeah, it does.
And so it gives you a little bit of clarity, right?
Clarity.
That research, when you're doing research, it has to be something very personal, okay, to you. Okay, meaningful to you. Intrinsically meaningful, not just extrinsically. Intrinsically meaning for you, passionate, something that you're passionate about. So that's all great stuff. So now what I'm going to do is, just in the interest of a couple of people who were not there yesterday, I just want to quickly breeze through what we talked about yesterday. Also, it will be a reinforcement. Oh, before I do that, I see Iman. Iman's hand has gone up. Iman, sorry.
it was already up. Okay, I wanted to ask, like the previously one of my compositors here was saying, sorry, I use a Swedish word. A colleague over here was saying,
"Hey, if we don't understand, we will just give you a look, deer in the headlight look."
Okay, so the thing is, like he was saying that it always we have to make the foundation really strong.
Right.
So, of whatever area we are searching on. So my query is that, for example, I'm talking about myself, not others. Yeah. Like for me, anything that attracts me or intrigues me, I just run into it. Like I don't have this boundary that this is going to be my field and I'm going to search on it. For instance, my bachelor's major was, I did my research on emotional intelligence in job market. Then in my MPhil, I went into, because I was working in clinical psychology, so I went into drug addiction. So I conducted a search on drug addiction, how they are managing, but I did connect it with emotions to some extent. And then lastly, the other masters I did in prototype journalization, how prototypes in different cultures actually affected. But I thoroughly enjoyed everything. I have a good command on now cognitive and emotional sciences. So for me, I mean, it depends on me at what point I'm intrigued or interested in a certain topic. I will develop my foundation from there. And they'll dive into it. So I don't specifically go for one thing. I don't know. Maybe it's right or wrong. But I would really like your opinion on that.
Okay. So, first of all, you know, I'm somewhat the same way. If something really catches my attention, catches my eye, and something that stirs me up emotionally or even psychologically, I get very drawn to it and I want to understand that. And it doesn't matter to me at that point in time. I'm not mindful of the boundary there. And maybe I should be more mindful of the boundary. Okay? Because sometimes what happens is inadvertently somebody's boundaries can be transgressed, okay? And here I'm talking about not just going into literature and reading up and or attending a conference in my area, but if I'm reaching out to somebody and I want that person to share with me the on that topic, and that person is hesitant or really even reticent about sharing with me, and I continue to press that because my interest is so strong, I can actually shut that person down or sorry for the expression, piss that person off. They're not going to want to talk to me, okay? So it's a fine line to draw, okay, where I can do my self-search and where I'm actually going to get the experiential knowledge from somebody who has actually gone, the person who's living through that experience,
okay?
So there's a balance. It's a very delicate balance, Iman, and that is, and perhaps, Everett wants to say something, maybe something to piggyback on your thought, maybe she can share. Go ahead, Everett.
Yes, what I was going to say, because I also teach like research to the nursing students.
Yeah.
And one of the things is like when I teach them or when we teach them about like reviewing the literature, like critiquing it, like research articles, one of the things they have to look at is the background of the writer, of the researcher. So say for example, if you're doing a research, it is good when you have mastery in that area, because persons can read your research in a negative way, because they'll be looking, so supposedly you're a psychologist and you're writing, doing a research about having to do with car auto, car mechanics, then the credibility of your findings and all of that, it's persons will kind of question it, because based on the background that you're coming from. So my perspective on it is that if you're doing research, it's yes, we all have interests in different things, but we have to have boundaries, because then it can affect our how persons view us and view our research.
Ah, nice. That is a good perspective. Very nice. And that's coming from your own experience as an educator there in Jamaica.
Yes, yes.
And because you're teaching nurses and you're teaching midwives and you're teaching all of those people and they're relying on you. And so if I hear you correctly, what you're also saying, Everett, is that when you're reading the research, it's important to know the worldview and the philosophy of the person that you're reading. Right?
Yes, yes.
Because if you're just reading, you're reading in a vacuum without knowing what that person's mindset is toward that, right? What are the person's historical background has been, okay? So all of that stuff comes into the picture because you're trying to formulate some thoughts based on what that person's thinking is, right? So Iman, does that sort of answer your question? Okay, Iman, we lost Iman there. Okay, but maybe she'll be back. All right, so what I'm gonna do is, I will just quickly breeze through this in the interest of those that were not there. So yesterday in part one, we talked about what is a research proposal, components of a research proposal, what does a research proposal contain? And now when I talk about research proposal, I'm not really talking about the full length dissertation, okay? The full length dissertation is typically going to have 5 chapters. The research proposal typically has 3 chapters, okay? Chapter 1, introduction, chapter 2, literature review, chapter 3, methods, methodology, and design, okay? All right, then what are the goals of a research proposal? So let's go and talk. And by the way, once again, I'm very, very grateful to a primary source that I've been referring to in these conferences yesterday and today, and that is Stephen R. Terrell. His work is cited at the end of the presentation, and I will be more than happy to share with you all an amazing ebook by him, How to Craft a Dissertation Proposal. Obviously, you know, I'm bringing in my experiences, I'm bringing in all my stuff, but I'm also relying on other philosophers, other theorists, and that's what research is. we just don't do research in a vacuum. It's not all our thoughts. Research is not about a researcher's opinion. It's about citing robust, reliable literature. So I'm using the work of Stephen Turrell, and along with that, I will also share with you after the conference two other sources. There's a dissertation study that was done full length on crafting research proposals. And she has gone into it from a different viewpoint into the philosophy and the psychology of creating a research. So between these three documents, you're going to get a tremendous amount of knowledge. Within 2 or 4 hours, I can only share with you previews, and I can have draw some knowledge from you, draw your thoughts and feelings about something, but I cannot make you an expert. A lot of this stuff, you will have to do self-reading. And then as I mentioned yesterday, and I'm repeating today also, I'm personally also available to whoever wants to work with me individually on developing their research proposals or getting more clarity on something. I'll be very happy to work with you separately on that. So please know that this learning has just started, okay? By no means is this the end, all right? So think of a research proposal as a formal roadmap that outlines what you want to research, where you are at today, where you hope to go, how you will get there, and what challenges you might encounter on the way. So just remember, what is it that you want to research? How are you going to go about researching it? Where are you going? Where are you headed? How are you going to get there? Are you going to get there by train, tram, flight, walking? How are you going to get there? I'm talking about the methodology, right? And what challenges might occur, and also implications for future researchers. So most research proposals will have the following components. Chapter one, as I said, introduction, background, and significance. Chapter two, literature review. Chapter three, research design, methods, and methodology. Preliminary suppositions. Okay, assumptions are a very important part, especially in qualitative research. You make assumptions about something, and those assumptions have to be delineated, they have to be outlined, typically in the research chapter number three, but also they have to flow from chapter two, a review of literature, okay? As you review the literature, you will see other authors also making certain assumptions. So you have to be able to bring those in into your study. The conclusion and references as citations. Remember, very, very important references and proper citations throughout your study. Goals of a research proposal, present and justify a need to study a problem. We were talking about, as we kicked off this program today, Anchal raised that question. What is to justify a need? So her need is to understand agriculture because she is intrigued by that. She has experience with that. So that is her need. And she wants to study that need, but not just study that need casually. She wants to research on that problem. Kanika said she wants to research about mindfulness in organizations. I wanted to research on negative capability because it was a concept that I heard in 2001, 2002, and I was so intrigued by it that I did my entire doctorate on the work of John Keats on negative capability, all right? So proposals contain extensive literature reviews. Now remember, this is very critical. I'm hovering my cursor here. Extensive literature reviews, not just a superficial review of literature, extensive. Now remember also that a proposal is different from a research proposal for application to a PhD program or an MPhil program is different in depth and breadth from a research proposal for a doctoral program. Once you're in a doctoral program, it's a formal document that lays out, sets the stage for your entire future journey, all right? So please be aware that when you talk about research proposal, don't take it loosely as that all research proposals are the same. All this one size fits all. No, the length, breadth will be different depending upon what the purpose of the research proposal is. So you have to provide a detailed methodology, including a statement of intended outcomes and challenges. This is chapter three. So these are the three chapters that make up an integral program, okay, a research proposal. So some research proposals will have other items like subheads, right? Give us a little bit of the background of the study, scope of the study, and all that. So please know that they all fall under the umbrella of these three chapters. These are the three meaty chapters of your research proposal. So I'm not going to read this, but I wanted to share this again because a lot of you are confused about this. You approach something linearly. And the thing is that while writing a research proposal, people get so bogged down with doing the introduction first that they forget that an introduction to your proposal is like a movie trailer. It's like a movie preview. Can the producer produce a good trailer without actually completing most of the movie? No, they cannot, because guess what? The producer is taking scenes from the entire movie, okay? Before the intermission, after the intermission, they're drawing scenes and putting them together in the form of a trailer. A trailer is like a teaser. So likewise, if you get so bogged down with the introduction, you're going to forget that you haven't done the rest of the work yet. So how are you going to, what are you going to write in the introduction? Your introduction is going to be very superficial if you don't bring in those pieces from your chapter 2 literature review and chapter 3 methodology and design. So keep your introduction last, all right? Let's jump to a review of literature. The precursor to conducting a robust lit review is identifying a clear problem statement. So your problem statement might be something like, okay, so I'm intrigued by this issue that I want to research, very broadly speaking. So I want to issue the research of, I was using the method demonetization yesterday, which happened a few years ago in India, created a lot of chaos, right? If I wanted to research that, it becomes a research problem for me. But is that the research question? Think of the research problem as a more macro thing and a research question as something micro. So within that broad framework, what is my research problem? And we'll talk about that later in this presentation when I get to the methods. But just please know that it is important to know both your research statement or problem statement and your research question. What is the focus of your research? What are you investigating? What is your research phenomena? A research question is not the same as a research phenomena. For instance, I might say, and let me give you my research question was, what is it like for leaders to be in a state of negative capability during periods of conflict in the workplace? Okay. Now, if you look at that question, again, what is it like for leaders to be in a state of negative capability during periods of conflict in the workplace? You can see that I'm talking about negative capability. So negative capability becomes my research phenomena. Whereas my research question is that one question that I shared with you just now. So you have to be able to discern, identify between what is your problem statement, what is your research question, and what is your research phenomenon. Does your literature review exist? Does any literature exist on your area of study? Or are you just going to be doing this out of the blues? Okay. Is your question even researchable? Are you going to be able to draw participants for your research? Are you going to be able to send out questionnaires for your research if you're doing a quantitative study? So feasibility is very important. Viability is very important. If there's no direct source of preliminary literature on a research topic, for instance, some people are researching very novel phenomena on which there is no existing literature or very sparse, very less literature available. What do? You drop it all, or do you go ahead and do? So what are you going to do? My research phenomena was very novel. There was hardly any literature on negative capability from the standpoint of leadership, because I was looking at it from the standpoint of leadership. There was some literature available in poetry and aesthetics around John Keats's work. All of you know John Keats was a famous English romantic poet in the 1800s. So now what do I do? So I went back to my faculty advisor and I said, you know, there is hardly any literature. He said, well, what would you do if it wasn't directly? I said, I don't know. So I was a novice. He said, when you don't have direct literature available on your topic, you go for ancillary literature. Other conversations happening around your research problem, around your research phenomena, around your research question. So I delved deeper into it and I tried to figure out what does negative capability represent? So it is a capacity to be in mysteries, doubts, and uncertainty without the impulse to do something about it. So there's two parts to it. The capacity to be in mysteries and uncertainties on the one hand, and on the other hand, resist the impulse to do something about it. And that, I said, wow, that represents a dialectical tension. Because on the one hand, I want to do something about it. On the other hand, I'm resisting the impulse to do something about it. So does it not create tension? So I said, wow, now I can find some literature on dialectical tension. Then that, as I was delving deeper into that, I suddenly realized, and I know Kanika is going to chuckle because she knows about what I went through back then, that I suddenly realized that this dialectical tension is also very related. There's a correlation with mindful awareness or mindfulness. Then as I started looking at mindfulness, I went into Zen Buddhism because Buddhism is all about mindfulness and mindful awareness. So see where I'm going with this? So one thing leads to another thing leads to another. Then I went into entanglements and transmedial thinking. Then I went into paradoxical thinking. All of that were not directly related to my phenomena of negative capability, but they were informing that phenomena. There were conversations happening around that. So the reason I'm spending a few minutes about this is to help you understand that don't get nonplussed if there is no literature or very little literature available on your topic. Go deep, make the connections, talk to people, attend workshops such as this, or attend conferences where your topic is being done, and then talk to people and they'll help you connect with other areas of the study. So indirectly addressing your problem is as valuable as addressing your problem directly with direct literature, okay? Now, framing a research question. A research topic is different from a research problem, which I just said, which is different from a research question. A well-defined research question narrows down the purpose of your study. While your research problem may be broad, a research question is narrow. It's in a few lines. If you're running into a whole paragraph, that is not your research question, my friends, okay? Your research question is to be crisp. It has to capture your research phenomena in it. And it has to, because remember, that's going to be your flagship. A research question is going to dictate your research methodology, your research design, how you're going to collect the data. What kind of data are you going to collect? Is it going to be qualitative, quantitative? So all of those things play into this picture, okay? A good research question is both interesting and researchable. So again, going back to Anshul's question, if it is not personally interesting to you, are you going to spend 4 years of your life? I don't know about you, but I would not spend 4 or 5 years of my life doing a PhD if I was not interested in that topic or my research question. It should be clear and concise, because guess what? Other academicians, other researchers are going to look at your study and they can say, oh my goodness, what kind of a research question is it? I don't even know what the researcher is trying to say. I have no idea. Okay, it has to be ethical. If your research question is not ethical, you're going to run into problems. Okay. First of all, it will not be approved within your institution, because there's an ethics board, ethics committee. In the US, yesterday I was mentioning IRB, Institutional Review Board, everything has to go through that channel because we are interviewing human subjects. But yesterday, Dr. Nitin had raised that he would like to interview, and it may not require an, even though it requires an informed consent form, it may not require doing human subject research. Because in human subject research, there's a potential for emotionally and psychologically damaging somebody. So therefore, these ethics are very important in research. And you have to be very, very careful every step of the way that you're not stepping on somebody's boundaries, that you're getting the necessary permissions, okay? Because guess what? It's become a litigious society now, especially in the US, but also now becoming more and more in India. They come back to sue you for something. So be careful, you know, protect yourself, keep your records very, very carefully. Because they, and in the US, you have to keep the records. All data has to be kept for 5 years under lock and key. You cannot have give anybody access to that data, all right? Enough said about that. Review of literature represents the major published works that inform your problem statement and research question. Like good research question, a robust literature review often guides your choice of methodology. Unless you've done a thorough review of literature, okay, you are not going to be able to understand how to frame your problem, research problem, how to create a research or craft a research question. What kind of research design are you going to have? And as I go later in the presentation to the methods area, I will talk about how I did it in my study, okay? And I sent everybody my doctoral dissertation. For a reason, I wanted to share it with you. I didn't want you to go out there and buy that book on Amazon and waste, not waste, but spend 800 rupees in India. So I sent it to you as the same exact content. So if you look at the, how I did it, you, it'll give you an idea, just a perspective, okay? Not a gospel truth that this is the way it is to be done. You know, different researchers write differently. There's a different, I have a different style. Other researchers that you read will have a slightly different style. But if you read a lot of different kinds of research, you will get an idea of how these people did the literature review. So yesterday, Rashmi was asking me a question. She said, I would like to have another session on this, because specifically she's having a challenge with how to connect the dots in her literature, how to make it in a coherent, organized way, such that it becomes a solid piece of work there for her dissertation. And so yesterday I suggested we can do it back channel and have a separate private discussion, which I will still have with Rashmi. But also yeah. I received another message from Mahmood, who could not be with us today. Mahmood, as you know, is from Saudi Arabia. He is a great guy and also looking at a doctoral program very seriously somewhere in Europe. And he had also requested me in his message to me that we'd love to have another makeup session so that we can go more in depth into some of the areas that we do. So I will be doing that one makeup session, no extra cost to any of you. We'll just do the another session, 2 hour session, about a week from now, and I'll keep you all posted on that. So any questions that come up, any spillover ideas, we can certainly work and do that. A thorough literature is a precursor to establishing generativity. We talked about generativity. A lot of you have already brought that up, which I'm so delighted to see that I know Siddharth had said, how is your literature going to, how's your study, how is your research going to help the community, you know, help your country, help other nations, okay? In addition to being added to your extant literature on the topic, what are the short-term goals for your literature, all right? So it has to be generative. It has to be progressive in the way that it helps, adds value to your work, okay? It serves several purposes, supports your study, supports future researches, and builds your subject matter expertise. One of the biggest things, and one of the things that people get very confused about is, So, sir, am I expected to become an expert in my area of study? Well, hello, you are the one that's going to be spending 4 or 5 years. If you're not the expert, subject matter expert, also known as SME, in your area of study, right? Then, and if you don't know more about your subject, then your faculty members, then guess what, my friend, you're in the wrong program. Take an example. Shika wants to, her area of study is gerontology. So if within gerontology, whatever her specific research question, specific research problem is, if Shika at the end of the program, by the time she's ready to defend, is not totally immersed and can say it backwards in her sleep, then there's a problem. You have to know, Shika, more than your faculty members on the committee. Am I right or am I wrong? Tell me.
Yeah.
Right, Shika? So if they know more than you, by the time you spend 4 years in the program, they're going to wonder, what the hell did you do? How much did you read up on this? You have to be able to wear the scholar hat, Shika, at that point, and say, sir, here it is. Not to be a wise ass, okay? And try to scare everybody or have a chip on your shoulder that I know everything. That's not what a scholar is. A scholar has reached, gone through the milestones, gone through the rigors, done the grunt work to read up, to delve deep, to understand the area of study in all directions, from all perspectives possible, and be able to regurgitate that. In a defense, they're going to ask you all sorts of questions. There's going to be a panel. If you're not able to rebut, if you're not able to defend your arguments, then what have you done for the last 4 years? Am I right? Shika, does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Not to scare anybody, but you have, unless you're a sub. Now, in my area of study, negative capability, I can tell you backwards. Because I've done so much thinking and research, I live and breathe that, even today, after my PhD has been done for several years. I still live and breathe that. I read up on that. Things intrigue me around that. So please remember that, okay? Review of literature. A literature review is not a paper on a topic. It is a paper on the research about a topic. So a lot of people think, sir, am I writing another topic or a paper? Like, because when you're in a PhD program or any program like that, you're writing a lot of papers on different topics, different foundational areas. You're not writing a paper, okay, per se. You're writing a paper about the research of a topic. It identifies key theories and theorists, requires a significant amount of selective reading, not general reading, but very selective, targeted reading. Critical to identify types of journals and keywords that you use. Identifies appropriate research strategies that are best suited for your phenomena. And by the way, I will share this PowerPoint with you. So don't worry about making copious notes. You don't require them. I will also be sharing not only the PowerPoint, but also other readings that I referenced for this. I didn't magically pluck this out of nowhere. Okay, I'm not a magician. I'm also a theorist. I'm also a scholar who relies on the work of other scholars. But when I take other scholars' work, I don't make it my own. I give them the credit. I give them the proper attribution, as you will see at the end of the thing. Everywhere, every step of the way, I will recognize their work. As long as you recognize people's work, as long as you give them attribution, give them the credit, you can use their work. That's what their work is there for, okay? Different methods call for different approaches, okay? So not one size fits all. So depending upon your research problem, you may have very different research approaches. Quantitative studies are deductive and require more extensive review because you start with a hypothesis or start with two different hypotheses and you are defending that. You are actually going through your entire study and proving or disproving a hypothesis. Now, my area of study, in all fairness, is not quantitative, so I'm not going to go into quantitative depth-wise. I'll just peripherally talk about that. My area of study, my specialty is qualitative, okay? So deductive, what does deductive and inductive mean, all right? Deductive means you start from something general and then you apply to a bigger population. Inductive means you start from something specific, right? And make some general observations. So look at this, one triangle like this and one triangle like that. So this is inductive. Right at the top of the pyramid is specifics. You're looking at specific interviews, specific cases, specific whatever, right? Narratives. And then you're drawing conclusions all the way down at the bottom are general observations, the base of the pyramid. Whereas in deductive, you start with a different theory, a broader generalization, and then go down and apply it to specific problems within society. They're done, for instance, a quantitative study in sociology will address a sociological macro problem or a sociological micro problem. So remember the difference between deductive and inductive. When you talk about quant, you're talking about deductive. You talk about qualitative, you're talking about inductive. It allows for new literature to evolve. So why is qualitative studies, why are they so dynamic? Because you don't start with a ton of literature, okay? You allow for new literature to emerge from the collected data as you interview, as you do all of that. So a new emergence occurs there. You have to identify keywords. If you don't identify keywords and you're doing searches, you'll be leading down different paths. You have to be able to identify keywords and phrases when you're going into and doing the searches. Okay. This is something that I covered yesterday, but I'm going into more depth into this right now, also for the benefit of a couple of other people. Identify keywords, develop an outline and annotate, then identify common themes that run across different strands. Because as you're reading the literature, one literature is by this researcher, another literature is by this researcher, then this one by this. You have to be able to make connections between those literature. And Rashmi, this is where is probably one of the most challenging parts. So you've read 10 different pieces that inform your phenomena, but you don't know how to connect these pieces together. How do these pieces, how do these theorists, how do these conversations talk between each other? That is where the skill lies in crafting an effective literature review. And that's where most students get bogged down. All right, they don't know how to, they know the content, they've done the searches, but they don't know how to put it together in a meaningful way, in a scholarly way. Extensively read other reviews that are done by researchers. So your literature review is one part, but also read up how others have done the literature reviews on different phenomena. It gives you an idea of how people approach that. Remember one thing, we're all in this together. It's a collective of academia. No one person is sitting there and doing all the research. No one person is sitting there and creative all these innovative things. We are all counting on each other. We are all working with each other, collaborating with each other, correct? Okay. Key features of effective literature reviews. Is the review easy to understand? Very, very key part. Is there a logical connection between the problem statement, research question, hypothesis? I talked about that. Do you feel like a subject matter expert after reading the review? If you don't feel like an SME, then there's something wrong. You spent 5 years of your life and you still are not a subject matter expert in your area. There's something radically wrong with your approach, or with probably you didn't spend enough time, or you're not interested in this program. Are you comfortable developing a research method based on the ROL? Very, very critical. Based on the review of the literature, do you feel enabled now to develop a research method out of that? Because you've also framed a research question. So how do you go about rolling this up integrating all these thoughts, connecting all these dots, and create some sort of a research problem or a research question. Now you might say, oh, but before I do the literature review, my research question should already be in my mind. Yes, to a point, your research topic is in your mind. Obviously, that is why you're doing literature review. You can't be doing literature review on topic A while your real topic is topic B, correct? So you have an idea of what you're researching. Of course, we don't go into this in a vacuum, in a fog. We know what we are going to be researching, but it's critical to have a selective research of the literature and be able to come up with some sort of a research problem. And then as you read the literature, you might actually go back and revisit your initial thoughts, which is okay, by the way. Nothing is set in stone. Nobody's got the gun to your head and say, oh no, aapne pehle to ye socha tha. How come you've turned it into something different? It changes, it transforms, okay? So please be comfortable with emergence, comfortable with uncertainty in the process. Things will change. Your research question will change. Your research direction will change. Your research design might change. But broadly speaking, you're researching on the same area, okay? Do not use Google. I cautioned you all, and I'm glad I'm repeating this. Please don't use Google, regular Google, to get citations or papers. Go to Google Scholar. Do not use Wikipedia. Wikipedias are opinions of people. Nothing wrong with it. It's interesting reading. Like if you want to know about what happened with Mughal kings, right? Okay, I can go on Wikipedia, look up and see some pictures, and there are some facts there, but they're not hard facts. They're opinions, interpretations of other people. You want academic literature. So go to Google Scholar, type in Google Scholar into Google and look for a search on Google Scholar. It is far more academic and well-sourced than regular Google searches. You can also go to ProQuest, put in keywords, and it'll pop up all the papers, all the dissertations, all the theses that have been done on your area of interest. And again, narrowing down your keywords is critical to doing a search, because those repositories contain literally thousands of dissertations. So if you're doing such a broad thing, if you put in conflict, I'm just giving an example, you're interested in a specific type of conflict, correct? And if you say, oh, conflict, that's a keyword, you put in conflict, you're going to be inundated. There's going to be 1,000 pages on conflict. Is this what you're looking for? Conflict in what? Now, when you say conflict in the workplace, you suddenly from 1,000 pages, it becomes 500 pages. But even that is too broad. You have to narrow it down further. You have to distill it further. You get the ithr, the essence of what is it that you're trying to research. The closer you are to the essence of what you're trying to research, the better yielding results you will have. Searching, and as Chandresh was saying, in today's day and age, information is at your fingertips. We're in the information superhighway. Everything is available so quick. It's all, today is the age of immediate gratification. Boom, boom, boom. Everything is available. But because everything is available, there's a downside. You don't know what the hell to select. You can't just be going on and on and on. You have to literally know what is it that you're trying to select. Rely on authors that are most frequently quoted in reliable journals with a high impact factor. Impact factor of a journal is how many times is a journal cited. You will often find this word IF, impact factor of a journal. Look for journals with a high impact factor. That obviously, if most people are quoting from that journal, then that there must be something about that author's work that is distinguishes it from others. Know how to distinguish between primary and secondary. Primary resources are original resources, original studies done by the authors. They are not interpretations of others. Secondary sources are interpretation of studies that were done by other authors. So as far as possible, go for primary sources. There are plenty of primary sources out there. Okay. Now we get into research. So you've done this entire literature review. You spent at least a year and a half doing literature review. Believe it or not, if you've spent only a month doing literature review, you're in a problem. A good literature review is an extensive, very elaborate process. So now you've done the literature review for your chapter two, but remember one thing, you have not closed chapter two. You've done the work, put it all together in a draft form, but keep it loose right now because some changes could be made. Now you're moving into the third chapter of your proposal, which is chapter three. It's called Research Methods, Methodology, and Design. Okay, now let's look at the first arrow. I'm going to put my cursor here because there's several arrows. A research question is your methodological starting point or your point of departure. It is your unique roadmap. I've been talking a lot about your research problem, research phenomena, but one of the major things is research question. That's why I have it in bold here. A research question is your methodological starting point, your unique roadmap. Research problem. So what is your research problem? Where do you want to go? So you are here today. I'm sitting here in the Philadelphia area. If I'm researching them, where do I want to go? If you don't know where you want to go, you'll end up nowhere. Or you might end up someplace that you never expected. So understand, where do you want to go? Research purpose, investigate different ways to get there. Now, if all of you have been listening, or some of you have been listening to me carefully, I've been talking about not one fixed way of doing things. You have to be open to emergence. I've been using emergence a lot, especially in the field of qualitative studies. Investigate different ways to get there. So is there one single way to get to where you want to go? No. If you take a side road, you can take a back road. How are you going to get there? Research question, your research question, what is the shortest and best way to get there? Here is where you're narrowing down to what is the shortest and best way to get there. So if you create a research problem, and if your research problem is too broad, you're going all over the place. If it is too narrow, you're not taking everything into account. You're getting too focused on just a few things and you're leaving out the rest. So your research question has to be a well-balanced statement, usually in the form of a question, okay? Research design. Now, what is the research design? So now you know your research question, you know where you want to go, how you're going to get there, research question, what is the shortest and best way to get there? So you have all of that. What is your research design? Is your research design quantitative, qualitative, or are you going to be using a mixed methods approach? Now, let me pause here for a second and open this floor out to you all to tell me how you would determine what research design to use. Don't focus on these first three or four arrows. Just focus on this arrow right here, where I'm using my cursor. Quantitative or qualitative or mixed methods, how would you determine that? Anybody?
Based on the problem statement.
Okay, tell me more.
So, what is that ultimately I'm trying to actually explore? For example, in the example that you shared about your negative capability and how the new thing emerged for you to look for conflicting situations, paradoxical situations, and you did your literature review around that. After that, when you start your own work, it'll help you what your problem statement is ultimately, that how do people handle paradoxes, for example. If that's your problem statement, that will help you define that whether you need to be establishing or testing the hypothesis basis quantitative data, or you need some kind of a phenomenological approach and using qualitative research, or maybe a combination of both. So that's what comes to me logically. That's a
no, you're getting there, but you're not quite there, and that's okay. Mm-hmm. If you said you're quite already there, then we will give you the PhD and send you on your way. But that's a really good way right. to look at it, because obviously when I was at your stage and level of understanding before entering into a PhD program, I was probably 10 times fuzzier than you are. Okay, but you have an idea, at least somewhat, of how to go about it, your problem statement, other areas to look for. But we have to answer this question: do I want to use quantitative? And if so, why? Do I want to use qualitative? And if so, why? I'm giving you a hint.
Yep.
Do I want to mix methods? And if so, why? So, Iman had raised her hand. Iman, you go first and then yeah. Everett.
Okay. As per your question, basically it depends on what we are searching. If we are going for quantitative research, let's assume that I started with a topic that there's less literature and I want to know, and then I'll go for qualitative. Mm-hmm. And at the end, if I think that I also still want to verify or validate my findings, mm-hmm. I can actually convert my findings into a psychological tool mm-hmm. and run a factor analysis and create a okay. tool. There I would be doing both kind of, searches. Like mixed mm-hmm. method. But as far as which statistical tool is concerned, it also depends on first my size of population, like how many variables I'm working on and what right. sort of things I'm looking for. Whether I'm looking for some impact factors, like is it affecting it or not, then I'll be going for regression. If I'm looking mm-hmm. for some correlation, then obviously it's going to be that again. But again, that also depends on if my sample that has been collected is normalized. Like I have mm-hmm. a normal sample, otherwise I'll be going for the other tests.
Okay, very but good. Then, correct. Then Everett, what is your take on that? Did everybody hear my question? You are going to decide which design to use. What would be the criteria for evaluating which design to use, whether it's quantitative, qualitative, or mixed methods?
I think I'm just saying just one thing. It depends on your research question.
Okay.
That's okay. what I have to say.
That is, of course, you gave us the textbook answer. How can I argue that? You took it right out of the textbook. That's the poster child of that. That is the rudimentary. That is the whole essence. That is the gospel truth. That your research question will define your research design, will evaluate your research design. But let's dig a little bit deeper into that. Everett, you've given us the answer, but we are not quite there yet. You've given us the classic answer, but tell me, anybody else?
Anil, I'm Nitin.
Yes.
So
go ahead, Nitin.
Yeah. Whenever you need the numbers, what? Where, when? I mean, the simple epidemiological questions. The answers yes. to those are normally hidden in quantitative. You give mm-hmm. the numbers, you test the hypothesis. Mm-hmm. So, but then beyond this, when you try to understand how the phenomena of something, how this is happening and why this is happening, you choose to do qualitative, and that's the reason why quantitative can be generalized while qualitative cannot. And that is the reason, there is a clear cut demarcation between quantitative and qualitative. And as Everett said, it actually depends on your question. So like in my research, what I'm doing is it's not about numbers. I know the numbers. I know how many frontline workers have tablets. I know how many people, how many of them have trained and all those things are already known. But then we still do not know why they are not using the tablet. Why this is still a barrier between them and the beneficiary.
Interesting.
And that answer will come from qualitative. And that is what I understand.
So the moment, so if I understand Dr. Bajpai, what he's saying is that on the one hand, you're looking at objective data, numeric data. We call it numeric data. On the other hand, when you want to understand why is it, what is their perception to it, what is holding them back? Can you measure that numerically? Probably not. You want to understand what is their perception, what are their resistances to it? Why are they not using? Why, like we, I made the use the analogy yesterday. If you remember, Nitin, we said, why is it that early cancer detected, they don't go for detection early? They wait, thinking that ye to kuch aur hai. This tumor is going to go away, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why should I get it checked out? Why should I get it diagnosed? Correct? Mm-hmm. So if you just wanted a longitudinal study of people with early detection, they waited 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. Yes, you can get a scale preference. They can say, I waited 1 year, 2 year, 3 year. That's numeric data. But if you want to understand why is it that they held on to it? Why did they not visit the oncologist earlier? Why did they not rush to the doctor? What was holding them back? Or another example, somebody that goes for a HIV test suddenly finds that, okay, the test results are not going to be given immediately to you. They will come to you later on, but please call us or please get in touch with us. And he or she refuses to want to know the answer.
Right?
Because the person is scared. God knows what this is going to be. I mean, it is going to be positive. Is it going to be negative? What is it going to do to my life? So hesitates, puts it off, delays getting, right, Nitin? As a doctor, you know that.
Right. I have a classic example. I mean, I don't know if people know it here. They might, but then it's a classic example that we were taught, and I have seen this. My father is a MD medicine, and he practices medicine. And
is your dad also a doctor?
Yes, he is.
Oh, wonderful.
And he's a tuberculosis specialist. So,
oh, my goodness.
This is a classic example that, you know, people in the back days in 1990s and 95s, when this tuberculosis program started in India, they had big, huge hospitals with big setups of X-ray machines.
Sanatoriums, they used to call them also, right?
Much after that. Already, like, tuberculosis program was already a vertical program. They were investing a lot of money. They were having infrastructure for different infrastructure for that. But then still patients were not turning up. So we knew the number. We knew the number gender-wise. We knew the number urban and rural-wise. We knew where the patients are and how the patients and where the patients are getting infected and all those things. The numbers were there. Mm-hmm. But then we couldn't understand why they're not turning up to the hospital. So when the qualitative studies were done, they found out that, the problem is the stigma. The moment a person goes into the hospital, he's stigmatized. Now people know that he was standing in the tuberculosis hospital. The society ostracized that person because he has tuberculosis. Nobody will talk to him in the village because he is tuberculosis. He has tuberculosis.
Oh,
now that one thing will stop him or her to come to the hospital. And that's why most of the tuberculosis patients were going to the quacks or probably to the private practitioners.
Mm.
Now these medicines, which were very expensive, were given free of cost, but then also the patients were not coming up. And that is how the program was changed, and then these dot therapy came, and dot therapy was delivered to their home because of a stigma. And I'm sure everybody will also agree with me on stigma for HIV. There are a lot of, as you said, a lot of people who got tested, but they never turned up. the address was wrong. The name was wrong. They never wanted their name to be revealed. So this is very important concept that, you know, quantitative gives you numbers, the gravity, because you have to plan a program. You cannot do the planning unless until you, you know the number, the gravity of it. But then you cannot go forward if you don't do qualitative analysis, because you will not be able to understand the behavior, which cannot...
There you go. The behavior, the perceptions, the attitudes of people. Right. They, you cannot do it by numbers. Okay, that's excellent. Yeah. Excellent. You've really rounded it up beautifully. But I want to also hear from others that have not talked about this, because I want everybody to really share in this. This is a very critical piece. All right. So who hasn't gone there? Let's see. Who would like to go next?
Hi, Dr. Anna.
Chandresh, go ahead, Chandresh, please.
So if I would take a dig at it, building on to what Dr. Nitin was also saying about subjective data, which is, you know, not very clearly defined versus the other where you have a very clearly set of defined data, I would kind of look at inductive and deductive as one of the areas that will help you to know on to which area your research is going to be based on. Is it going to be quantitative or qualitative? Because to explain that, within the deductive one, where there is already a lot of the numbers and data available, and then you're trying to zero down to understand how that, how those are interacting with each other and what results they give. While on the inductive one, you're going out there with a certain hunch about what you know, but a lot of things that you don't really know about. And then you do your qualitative work to bring in those points of data sets, and then do the comparisons to understand how they interact with each other and influence the final outcome.
Okay. Excellent. So what does that mean? Let's unpack what he just said, what Chandresh just said. So Chandresh said, depending upon whether you want to do inductive or deductive. So let's say deductive, right? So you already have some theories around that, or already the grand, which we call them in quantitative, we call them grand theories, right? Correct, Chandresh? Grand theories, right?
Correct.
So then they're applying that to a specific problem.
Right. Yes, absolutely.
So is that your goal? Are you looking for a grand theory? And there are plenty of grand theories out there, very well researched, everything that you want to apply there. If you're satisfied with that and you want to do the study based on that, that's fine. But if your approach is inductive, I-N-D-U-C-T-I-V-E, then you are looking at specific to more general. What do I mean by that? You're going to interview specific, in Dr. Nitin's case, patients, right? With semi-structured in-depth interviews, or do a focus group, correct? To understand what are their perceptions, what are the stories they're telling you about that? Because you want to understand, you want to go rich, you want to collect rich. And rich data is also known as thick data, T-H-I-C-K, thick. Thick data is rich data, voluminous data, because you need in qualitative research, thick data. You just don't need one-liner. One-liner answers are okay for quantitative, because you send somebody 100 questionnaires, they check off something, it's just one line, maybe not even one line, they just check something off and it comes back to you. But in qualitative, you have to dig deeper. Tell me a little bit more about that. So what stopped you from understanding that? Or what stopped you from talking about it? Or what stopped you from wanting to get to know your HIV result? You're trying to get at the attitudes. So you go for specific cases. Every case in qualitative, especially in interpretative phenomenological analysis, IPA, and in phenomenology, we are looking at specific cases on their own terms, in their own words. You look at each and every rich case, then you take up the whole roll-up of cases, And then you figure out what are the emerging themes from there. You separate superordinate themes from subordinate themes. And here I want to call upon my dear student, Everett, because Everett is currently doing this, right? She's just bursting with knowledge right now. Everett, let's talk about this a little bit. Are you there, Everett?
Yes, Dr. Anil.
Okay, I thought you had already left us.
No, I'm still here.
Okay, so tell us, Everett. So what I just said was, we are talking about inductive approach, right?
Right.
So you have done interviews, correct?
I have, yes.
Right. So in the interviews, you're looking at each and every case on its own terms, right?
Right, uh-huh.
And then you're collecting the data. You've already collected the data. You're looking at each interview narrative on its own terms. Then you're rolling this up and determining. Tell us a little bit about how you determine the superordinate and subordinate themes.
Okay. So in my case, I'm dealing with 8 participants, which I interviewed all at like 3 series of interviews for all 8 participants. So
tell us about your research. Tell us about your research. What is your research question? Tell us that first.
Okay, so my research question entails newly qualified midwives, how the challenges that they have transitioning into midwifery practice.
Okay.
All right. Okay. So I want to find out the challenges that they are encountering. So I did 3 sets of interviews among each participant. So the point I'm at now, as Dr. Anil says, is that I'm now collating, putting together the themes, the recurring themes that comes out of the 3 series of interviews for each participant. So after finishing that, then I will now look across all 8 and then to see themes that are alike and if there's any differences. So the themes that keeps on coming up, the most occurrent, the ones that occurs most frequently, the dominant ones, those ones will be determined as the superordinate themes. And then other themes which are consistent to the same theme that I'm looking at, but which is of lesser degree of occurrence within the narratives, then those will then become my subordinate themes.
So, did everybody get that? Superordinate and subordinate.
So superordinate is the most dominant one, exactly. The dominant theme. So say, for example, I can just give a little example. If you're trying, somebody comes and says, okay, I want to build a house. Your participant's interview surrounds building a house, all right? So from that, based on what the narratives is saying, the superordinate theme could be desire of building a house. However, the subordinate themes would be, because you know when you're building a house, you'll need the material, you need to pay workmen and things like those. So then those then would become like the subordinate themes. They're still relevant to, like the desire to build the house, but then the subordinate theme would be, for example, my payment of workers, or it could be material to build a house. Something of that effect.
Wonderful. Very well. Nicely done. Excellent. And that's a great way of putting it out there. So if you're, once again, getting back to what I was saying, thank you, Everett. I appreciate it. So if getting back to what I was saying, the choice of research design, yes, your research question. So what was Everett's research question? What are the challenges new midwives face as they enter the program? Correct? Now, one might say, okay, I can do a quantitative study. I can say, okay, this challenge, that challenge, that challenge, that challenge, and they'll tick off and send you the questionnaire back. Is that really what she's trying to understand? A challenge is not numeric. A challenge is a very subjective thing. What can be challenging to me may not be a challenge for another midwife. And how one midwife talks about challenge is not the way another midwife is talk about challenge. So if I want to delve deeper into their subjective experiences, not objective, subjective experiences, my research design would be qualitative. Now, within qualitative, what kind of design do I go with? Do I go with phenomenology, which is understanding the essence of a phenomena? Do I want to do action research? What is happening on site in the hospital? Do I want to do ethnography? Which means, as a researcher, I go native into the hospital. I immerse myself in that culture. Usually ethnographers work for 3 to 6 months to a year sometimes. They're totally immersed, embedded in that culture, because what is ethno? Ethno is culture. It's the study of culture within a system. And how do you understand the system culture? By delving into, by sitting in the meetings, by talking to their managers, by understanding what is happening in the cafeteria, how are people? So to understand the culture, content analysis is somewhat similar to what we do in phenomenology. You would be looking at the whole content from the interviews and making some sort of analysis. Narrative is about stories. What story structures people are using to describe a phenomenon. IPA is interpretative phenomenology analysis. And I'm talking about this baby here, okay? My cursor is right here. So the IPA is interpretative phenomenology analysis, which has to do with direct lived experience. What is it like for unwed mothers to raise children in a single family household? Okay? So if I'm doing an IPA study, I would have to recruit unwed mothers. One, the criteria. Two, they have children. So how are they raising children? And their husbands may have either deserted them or whatever, have not shown up or whatever happened. They're raising single family, in a single family household, they're raising children. And these children were born out of wedlock. There was no marriage there. Or what is it like? And I know Shika has left the thing. She just sent me a WhatsApp message and I feel bad. She's suffering from some lower back pain. And she had told me as the start of the session that she may not be able to sit for too long. So we feel bad for her. Hopefully she'll feel better. But so if the question was, what is it like for you to suffer from chronic lower back pain? Her pain is not chronic by any stretch of imagination, but if we are looking at chronic lower back pain, I've suffered from lower back pain, and a lot of other people suffer from chronic lower back pain, which most of the times tends to be mechanical, okay? And with stretching and with physiotherapy, you can get some relief, but sometimes it's also physiological. There are changes that are happening in your vertebrae. There are degenerative changes that are happening. So if you are looking at that kind of question, you're looking at the specific interviews and what is coming through those interviews regarding lower back pain. So you'll have to recruit people who have chronic lower back pain, because those are the people who have direct lived experience about that. Grounded theory is another animal that we talk about here, which is about building a new theory about something or refining an existing theory. Grounded theory is also an inductive approach, also uses a lot of interviews, actually a series of interviews, going back through iteration and to discover data. So everything is grounded in the data. I'm just giving you some quick examples of qualitative research methods. So just wanted to, I know this will fill your head with a lot of stuff. Some of you who are already in a doctoral program, this might not come as something very new. It may be a regurgitation of that. But Anchal, so Anchal, what do you think about this? How would we determine a design?
I cannot think. I don't know if I can add something right now. I'm just
okay. That's fair. No problem. Yeah, as long as you are there with us, that's fine. So here's the thing: if you're doing a proposal and you're doing a proposal for a doctorate, okay, I'm just taking an example for a doctorate. A lot of people get confused. So thereafter, the dream is I must get the PhD, right? The PhD, but we use it so loosely that we forget that the PhD is actually a doctor of philosophy. So they are so intrigued by the idea that they're going to become the doctor, and everything that goes into getting the doctorate, courses and interviews and data collection and data, and that they forget that there is such a thing as philosophy. And getting back to the earlier thing when we were talking about research of literature, or we posed the question about what is your philosophy? Philosophy is a belief system, value system that you go by. It could also be a worldview that you adopt to. So the doctor, yes, but where is the philosophy? So let's take a look at that. Your research philosophy dictates the path you will take to approach your research question and methods. I kept that deliberately here so that you will understand what that really entails here. So axiology, you'll hear these axiology, ontology, epistemology, and methodology. It is a flows one. So you see these arrows, flows one from the other. Axiology, beliefs about what is ethical. So remember I told you your research has to be ethical. Your research study has to be done ethically on an ethical topic. Ontology. Ontology is the nature of being. We attribute ontology to the work of Heidegger. If you're doing phenomenology, he talks about what is it like to be. So when I ask the question, what is it like for you to be in a state of negative capability? Or was it like for you to suffer from chronic lower back pain for 10 years? Or what is it like for you to raise out of wedlock children in a single family household? These are questions that are ontological in nature, beliefs about the nature of reality or the nature of being. Ontology is the philosophy of being, the nature of being, or what is it like to be. Epistemology is something you'll hear a lot. Okay, it's also a philosophical approach. What are your beliefs about the research? Okay, what is it about the research, about knowledge? Not just the research as in your research study, but what are your beliefs about knowledge? Is your belief that knowledge is about active involvement? Or is your belief that knowledge comes from detached observation? Now listen to this very carefully. So if you have a belief system that pure knowledge, P-U-R-E, should only come from detached observation, you're in the positivist camp, because quantitative researchers take a detached observation role. They feel that if they get too close to the, and in quantitative research, we call them respondents. If they get too close to the respondents, then you will be corrupting the study, corrupting the data. So they remain hands off. By contrast, in qualitative research, there's an active involvement of the researcher. The researcher takes a paradoxically bilateral approach. What do we mean by paradoxically bilateral? Bilateral means goes two ways, right? Two-way street. Paradoxically means you're holding a paradox between knowing and not knowing, doing and not doing. So when you take a paradoxically bilateral stance with a participant, now in qualitative research, you don't call them respondents. You call the research study participants, but we call them participants. So when you're dealing with them, you're taking an active involvement. You're asking them probing questions. You're directing the study, but you're also listening to them. You have to understand when to become dominant in the interview and when to become submissive in the interview. So there's you're co-creating the knowledge, right? Which is not the case in detached observation or in quantitative studies. In qualitative studies, you are creating knowledge, especially when you're doing phenomenology and when you're doing interpretative phenomenological analysis. So by the way, phenomenology is not the same as IPA or interpretative phenomenology analysis. Phenomenology is the general philosophy. It's not even a methodology, believe it or not. It's the philosophy of research. And IPA is interpretative phenomenological analysis. It's an approach to collecting and analyzing data. Okay, just know that. Methodology, the actual approach deployed by researcher to address the research question or hypothesis. So if you look at these, this diagram, right, one thing flows from another, okay? You have to have, so it's not a linear thing, you have to have it all going together in your head, but you have to know, not just what your preference is. Your preference is one part, but again, as my esteemed friends were talking about earlier in the conference, that it has to be determined by something more robust than just your own preference. I have a distaste for data. I have a distaste for math, let's say. I'm just saying hypothetically, which actually I don't prefer math. I'd rather do qualitative. But if I just had preference for qualitative, okay. And if my research question actually demands or warrants a quantitative study, and because my preference is not quantitative, what I will try to do is I will either steer it, I will bastardize that approach, debase that approach, and go into doing it qualitatively when the actual research question is asking for numeric data. What an idiot I will be. What a fool I will look like. So it's not about what your preference is. It's about what your research question is guiding you to do, what your philosophy of research is guiding you to do, directing. So there's a very systematized approach to doing this, okay? So keep your preferences last, all right? Now, within qualitative, let's say you've decided you're gonna do qualitative. Within qualitative, you can look at the same research phenomena in many different ways. You can craft and recraft a phenomena and a research question, and then change the way that phenomena can be studied. Okay, so if you're not looking at direct lived experience, if you're just looking at generically, what is it? What is the meaning structure of abuse, emotional abuse? Anybody can talk about emotional abuse, right? So you don't literally have to recruit participants who have lived emotional abuse in their lives. You could just get any participants out there who can talk about that. It's generic, it's very general. But when you are looking for lived experience, you go into IPA. The first case, you could look at it phenomenologically. Then if you look at what are the meaning structures, you might want to take a look at narrative research. Then if you look at what factors engage in this process, what factors make you decide which direction to go? The moment you bring in factors into something, you are looking at grounded theory. So I guess what I'm sharing with you is that once you decide that your research question is best answered by a particular research design, whether it's qualitative, quantitative, or mixed methods, then your field becomes clearer. Within that, then you can see what your choice of methodology is going to be. So let's go to the next. Inductive versus deductive. We already talked about that, so I'm not going to talk too much about inductive and deductive. But just here, it involves moving from particular facts to general conclusions. Quantitative involves inferences from general principles. Okay. You apply a general principle and then you draw an inference. I talked about the two pyramids, right? Mixed methods is becoming very popular now, which uses both inductive and deductive, involves addressing the research question or hypothesis using numeric and non-numeric data in the same study. So in the same study, you will have both a quantitative piece and a qualitative piece. The complexity and the nuanced nature of mixed methods is your quantitative and qualitative have to talk. So here's the dilemma. How would you make numbers, which are objective, talk to thoughts, feelings, and emotions, which are subjective? I want to open that out to the group. It's very critical. You have to understand more and more people are doing mixed methods now. So Iman, go ahead.
Yes, one second, sir.
I need to, and okay, yeah. So from like as per your question, basically, if you have already, like for me, if I'm going to do mixed method, I'm going to start with qualitative and that leading to quantitative. Why so? Because the emotions or things that I picked up from qualitative are the ones which will be used to get the quantitative data. So that way I can connect both of them, because whatever I generated in quantitative was actually built from qualitative, you know?
Okay.
So I think, yeah, I mean, if I have...
Okay. But why not the other way around? Actually, I've seen more people do quant. First. And here's the interesting, and here's the interesting part. I always chuckle. They say, okay, like a lot of times I've had students in India and they're saying, you know, my research advisor is saying, but you are so much in love with qualitative research, but kya chhapwana hai, dissertation karwana hai, journal koi nahi chhapega aapka kaam, right?
Okay. No, I think when you ask, can you connect? Okay, when we talk about qualitative, like you initially, when you were talking about deductive and inductive reasoning,
right.
So things with quantitative are already deducted, okay? So we already know what happened. Why we are doing it again, or why we are, because we are looking at it in a different perspective. If that was already there, we didn't need to go for qualitative in the first place.
Yes, okay? so that's a good observation to make. So if you know the numbers, this, you know that these so many people in the population have this preference, or this distaste, or whatever, then you can approach and piggyback that with a qualitative study and say, why is it that they approach it like this?
Yeah.
What are your feelings, thoughts about that?
Yeah, that's the point. But if, like, then we are going for thoughts and point again, we will be just putting it in a different way. It's similar as when we do cross-cultural research. Maybe the same research has been already done. Why you are doing it is the way you're going to put it out there. Like, I'm looking from this perspective, the other person is looking from that perspective.
Great.
So maybe that is why I'm going through this, you know?
Okay. Anybody else? Anybody else want to share something on this? Okay. So I guess I'll go to the next slide. Let's unpack a qualitative method for chapter 3. Okay, so I'm going to take the example of IPA, and I've already sent you my dissertation, so you can take a look at that. You could pour into that and see how I've done it. But let us say you want to do a qualitative method. You have to describe, right, in chapter 3, what is it that you're going to be doing? You're going here, you want to know how you're going to get there, what methods you're going to use, et cetera, right? So here are some of the things that you will need to start your chapter with. You will, of course, restate. And by the way, your researcher's research question must keep popping up in all your chapters. Times in each chapter, but at least once in each chapter. You have to restate the research question, because as the reader is reading your study, the reader wants to be reminded, what is it that you're researching, right? What is your research question? So restate your research question, the history, origins, and theoretical foundations of IPA. So I, in my research, if you go into my dissertation, chapter 3, you will see exactly where I'm going with this. And when you compare it with this PowerPoint, it'll all become clearer to you. So I talked about the history, origin, and theoretical foundations of IPA, which is important, right? Because the reader wants to understand. Now remember, even if I'm applying for a PhD program, and I'm doing this research proposal for a PhD program, they want to know what your research question is, and history, origin, not in a full length history and theoretical foundation, but they want to at least get some idea that you know what the history of this thing is, you know, origin and theoretical foundations of IPA. Because they want to know, why is it that you're using IPA? Now, if you're talking about ethnography, or you're talking about action research and narrative, they're all that have been around for 60, 70, 80 years. But IPA is very new. It's been hardly around for 50, maybe 10, 15, 18 years. So they, somebody reading your study, what is IPA? Never heard of IPA, right? Of course, now more and more people know IPA. When they talk about phenomenology, they know IPA. But you have to help them understand what IPA is. What are the theoretical foundations of IPA? What are the pillars on which IPA rests? Then, in my case, I used IPA study 1 and 2, two mini studies that were done using interpretative phenomenologic analysis in the extant literature. I pulled them out because my research guide wanted me to illuminate two examples of IPA so that the reader can understand how that interpretative phenomenologic analysis is done in many studies. So study 1 and 2, not elaborate, even just 1.5 pages on each study. Delineate phenomenology, hermeneutic circle. You are using certain mumbo jumbo, some words, some expressions that don't assume that the reader knows. Okay, you have to talk about phenomenology. What does phenomenology mean? Hermeneutics. Hermeneutic circle, Wersterhan, the rejection of positivist science, ideography, meaning specific and particular. So you have to give them a few definitions of that. Epistemological concern. We talk about epistemology, remember? On knowledge. What is it about IPA? Right? How does knowledge come into the development of IPA? Not just theory, but about knowledge we're talking. Pilot study, did you do a pilot study? Are you planning to do a pilot study? They want to know that. Data collection, how are you going to collect the data? How are you going to do the interviews? What kind of interviews you're going to be doing? What are your assumptions? What are you assuming? Because in qualitative studies, especially phenomenology and some of the other studies, you have to use a process called bracketing. You bracket or keep aside your own assumptions, frameworks, ideologies, and philosophies aside as you're collecting data with the idea that your own subjective biases do not interfere with the collection of the data. So don't worry about that, but just remember there's a thing called bracketing, which I talked about in my chapter 3, main study design, analysis, and interpretation. So if you look at my dissertation, you will be able to really understand what I was talking about here. So you'll get a hang of that. All right. So just remember, in chapter 3, it's a very involved, detailed oriented chapter. It is not putting it all together, one piece here, one piece there. It has to be written in a specific way, shape, and form. So that, and by the way, your chapter 1, 2, 3 all should flow from one another. There should be a connection between all three chapters. Okay, so I'll go to the next. Title of proposal, introduction and background. So remember now, we talked about keep the introduction last, right? I shared with you and I shared it again today, keep the introduction last, do the introduction last. Make the movie trailer after you've completed most of the movie so that you can do justice to it. Your introduction is like a movie trailer for the entire project. What problem are you addressing? This is your introduction chapter, by the way, folks, chapter 1. And you might be wondering, oh gosh, first he talked about chapter 2, then he talks about chapter 3, now he's talking about chapter 1. I am sort of like replaying it back to you that this is where now you will begin to see why your introductory chapter 1 begins to make sense if you do it last. What problem are you addressing now through your literature review, through your research statement that you made, your problem statement? Now you are able to define the problem that you're addressing in a better way, in a clearer, more succinct way. How will you go about the problem, right? Again, in the introductory section, you have to introduce the reader to all of this stuff. Don't assume that they know where you're going. You're taking them with you, but you also let them know that, hey, follow me around. These are the streets that I'm going to be taking. This is the roadmap we'll follow. How will you go about the problem? Why would readers care to read? Why would readers care about what you're writing? And here is the part where people miss the mark. their introduction is blah, 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 all facts, 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 figures, 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 figures. There is no intrigue there. If I use a novel and if I start reading a book and my friends, and if the book doesn't have capture my attention in the introductory chapter, I'm going to keep it aside. So an introduction is such an important part of that. You have to create the intrigue, create the interest, create the curiosity in the reader. Provide an example or case scenario. So sometimes if you're talking about something that you're going to be researching, you provide a case example, a scenario from your own, like Chandresh and Nitin and all of us, many of us have a lot of work experience that we can draw from generically. Keep the pseudonyms, don't use actual names. Provide a case scenario that this is what was happening and pose a question there. It creates an intrigue. People want to know more about it. Okay, so if I've talked about negative capability, you'll see how I created a case scenario in my introduction chapter, in my dissertation. It creates curiosity because I'm talking about negative capability and the practice of negative capability and the exchanges of negative capability in that case. How does it add value not only to yourself, but to the community at large, to the society at large? They want to know, how is it going to add to the literature? So you might just say that during your searches of the literature, you did not find enough literature on this, and you hope that and remember, use tentative expressions like this if you're doing qualitative. Use the word speculative, use the word hope, not that, oh, this will do this and this will do that, because you never know the ultimate truth, okay? This is all subjective. And that's what makes qualitative research difficult. How does it add value? How will it help you achieve your academic goals? Especially in this box is very, very critical while writing a research proposal for admission to a PhD program. I was talking to Kanika because I know Kanika is in the process of applying for doctoral programs and she's looking at a few programs very closely. And we were talking about the statement of interest. Okay, usually they'll ask you to write a statement of interest. And in that, you have to say, how will that program help you achieve your academic goals? What contribution are you planning to make to it? And I was, as I was telling Kanika, and I think I know Kanika won't mind me sharing this with you. Sometimes you have to, when you're writing these proposals, don't wear the hat of the expert. Especially when you're applying to a doctoral program, wear the hat of a novice, but not an uninformed, ignorant novice, an informed novice, who's going with the notion that I already have some idea about what it is that I want to achieve. And here's the way the institute will help me. Here's the way the academic program that I'm going for is going to help me. Keep it open-ended. Keep it like nothing helps your case more than academic curiosity, genuine academic curiosity, not a head full of stuff. They don't want, guess what? They don't want you there because you're not going to be coachable. You'll try to teach their faculty. What is that? And yes, there will come a point when you become a subject matter expert and you will actually teach the faculty what they don't know about mindfulness, right, Kanika? But that's what it is. So you have to remain in that state of innocence, not naivete, but innocence, academic curiosity, okay? Here are the primary references and further readings. We are right on time. Heath, Trisha, and I'll share this with you. Terrell, writing a proposal. This is an entire ebook that I'll share with you also. Please feel free to use them for your own, but I would really ask that you not share these too openly and too publicly with others outside of your immediate community, okay? It's not done in good taste because these are all authors that have really generously shared their work. but they've not shared their work to the whole entire world and put it out there. Although I'm sure that if you go into do a Google search for Terrell SR, he's probably the entire PDF will show up. But I am just saying, as an academician and as someone who has a great deal of respect for others' work, that even if you're using the work, make sure that you're using for your own private consumption, that you don't put it out there for the whole world, okay? And I will share this with you. And just on that note, what I wanted to do was, let me go back to the previous slides there, to the beginning of the program. As I said, I will be very happy to do a makeup session where we will go into more in-depth. And during this 1 week, if you guys can tell me specific areas that you would be interested in, then I will customize another session for you. And again, no cost to anybody. You already have paid for this program. So we will do a 2-hour session about a week or 10 days from now, in which we will try to address your questions as best as we can and tailor make that for you. Now, in addition to that, if you need my help and support individually, I'm always there. I'm only a email away from you, okay? So on that note, I just want, before I finish off, I would just want to open the floor to you, and if anybody wants to say something, please feel free.
Anil?
Yes, Anshul, go ahead.
Actually, I wanted to ask the difference between an assumption and a hypothesis.
Oh, that could take me 10 minutes to explain, but I will explain it in a minute. How does that sound? So assumptions are, when you're doing a study, you assume certain things. Like we have a study phenomena, you have some knowledge about something, you, through your readings, through your, you know, various interactions with others, you have some ideas about that, correct? They're not based on any particular theories. They're based on your interpretation of what is happening in the world outside you, and also in the world inside you. So you make some assumptions. So you might say that my assumption, so if you're talking about unwed mothers raising children in a single married, a single parent household, you might assume certain things about that. So you have to delineate, you could describe those assumptions. What is it that you assume based on what you think you know or what you might know directly or indirectly about that? Those are your assumptions. So you have to describe, you have to outline your assumptions, all right? Usually these assumptions come in chapter 3 in the research design and methodology chapter, okay? What is a hypothesis? Hypothesis is different from an assumption. Hypothesis is based on a more rigorous, even though hypothetical says, oh, it's tentative, don't think of the colloquial meaning of hypothetical or hypothesis. A hypothesis in an academic lingo means a very rigorous. You have formed a hypothesis based, and again, it's outside the boundary of this conference right now to talk in any length about that. You and I can discuss this separately, but all I wanted to say is a hypothesis is you're formulating something very rigorous based on your understanding, based on the literature review. You're forming a hypothesis. You're saying, this is hypothetically, this is what I think is going on there. Then in your quantitative and hypothesis, I basically never used in qualitative studies. They're always used in quantitative studies. So when you do a hypothesis or you do dual hypotheses, you go out there to prove or disprove your hypothesis through numeric data. Does that answer your question?
Yes. Yes, it does. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Anybody else wants to share anything before we wrap it up?
Hi, analyst Nitin.
Go ahead, Nitin.
Yeah. The only request is, now that this session is over, I guess I see the third session which you would be planning, and thank you for keeping that is more important, because now I guess the need to have that third session is more relevant.
Correct. And I'm glad you mentioned that, because one of the reasons what I would like to do is between now, and it doesn't matter whether you do it in 1 week or do it 10 days, we don't want to do it thorough. So if you, for the third session, let's have some homework for participants here to create.
Yeah.
You don't have to do something elaborate. Think about a research question. Think about a research phenomena. Think about what is it that you write in literature review for that. Second, just loosely, we can create proposals. And then we can just discuss some of your proposals here, right? And yeah. I can share excerpts from your proposals here. Nothing really elaborate. Whatever, don't be shy. Just write whatever comes to your mind.
Yes, yes.
So we want to make it meaningful, because then it is an application of the knowledge and just not just knowledge for knowledge's sake. Correct?
Yes.
Is that helpful?
Yes, I'm
right.
Okay. Anybody else want to share anything before we wrap this up?
Thank you, Dr. Anil. It was very insightful. Yes.
Thank you.
And like I was saying yesterday, very lucid. I think we were able to cover up a lot of the most core fundamental areas that are important before we are getting into a research domain itself. And understanding this is very important. So thank you very much.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Very welcome. And again, my challenge always is that I have a lot more to say and very little time to say it in. You know?
Understand.
So my time management, it can sometimes go awry. Because my brain is wired differently. I don't go too much with strict time boundaries. And that's my own weakness. So I'm always looking at so much material that I have to cover it in 2 hours. And so the decision always is, do I give too much? Do I give too little? Okay. If I give too little, then people think that it's not there. Or do I have too much content and very little process, right? Too much of dialogue, didactic learning, and too little of experiential learning. So the one thing that could really help you all is, just in my estimation, is you do up, just pick up a research topic, do a short piece on that, even if it's like a concept note, right?
Right.
I don't want you to do the whole in-depth, extensive literature review on something unless you're already engaged in it. Like Nitin, you're already into it, and Chandresh has already sent me something to look at, and I know Kanika is also all working on that, and Shika is working on that, and Rashmi, all of you actually are working on that. So if you would send that along, then we can look at it and we can see, you know, present a few samples here in the third session of how we are going to be going. And we could probably keep the third session a little bit longer so that we can address most of your issues. Okay?
Yeah, makes sense. Yeah.
All right.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Are you squared away, Rashmi? Are you okay?
Yeah.
With that?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay.
Sounds perfect.
Great. Thank you all for a terrific session once again.
Thank you.
And we look forward to meeting you again. And I will be back in touch with you all. Okay?
Thank you so much.
Take care.
Thank you. Thanks, Anil. Bye-bye. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Dr. Anil.
Yes.
Bye-bye. Just a minute to everybody. Please don't leave. Sir, just a suggestion. If you can have a WhatsApp group for this group, so that we can keep in touch with everybody.
So why don't I actually, believe it or not, I forgot to mention this, but I had requested Kanika to be the moderator. And yesterday, for whatever reason, she missed. Then she tell me, okay, you never WhatsApped me. I said, Kanika, ye sabko bheja tha humne. So she missed out on that. Our bad luck. She was not there. So this is going to be on Kanika now. So if Kanika, would you be willing to start that WhatsApp group?
Yes, but I do not have everyone's contact. Once I have that, I will definitely do that. Like,
no,
why not take a minute and write down the numbers now itself?
No, instead of doing that, what I would suggest is I'll send out a note, like an email, with a request to everybody to send your contact information to Kanika.
Okay.
Okay.
Sure. Perfect.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to email. Yeah, I think we're all copied on the same email chain, so I can everyone can reply their numbers on that one, and then I can.
Everybody is openly copied on that. So you just respond to Kanika and give
just reply. Just reply to me so that you know everybody's inbox is not spammed. So just
correct,
be mindful.
Correct. So just respond mindfulness, to Kanika you see. Only. And then I would love to do this because this could be another, and this is a great way suggestion, Nitin, because we can continue the learning, okay, and continue sharing with each other in a small group. And because small, large groups of WhatsApp become very disparate, okay, they become chaotic, okay. We need this group to be a very focused group, okay?
Yeah, sure.
And we can network in the future to write research.
Okay, Everett, take care.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Okay. Bye.
Thank you.
All of you.
Good night.
Have a good day. Good night.
Bye.
Okay, good night. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.